Welcome to AIM TV. I'm Roberta Wayhill, and I have a special guest today, Gray Wolf. He's Yoem Apache. He is the curator of the Chumash Indian Museum in Thousand Oaks. He also plays in the Gray Wolf Blues Band and, among other things, Gray Wolf Productions. So welcome, Gray Wolf.
Nice to be here.
So one of the many things that you do is you are the curator of the Chumash Indian Museum in Thousand Oaks. We had the opportunity as with the last powwow to visit the museum and the grounds, and it's a beautiful piece of property. You have a lot of interesting things in your museum. Can you talk about some of the items and the displays that you have?
Sure. Besides the museum collection, which is one of the nicer collections of Chumash artifacts, we have stone bowls and we have mortars and all kinds of great stuff. It was actually made by the Chumash people. Some of it was actually found on the property, so it's very interesting that it's there. We also have 432 acres of land that it's one of the oldest oak groves left in California, intact oak groves, and so it's a very beautiful place. We have trees that are 200 to 300 years old. So it's we also have a herd of deer that lives there. All these animals are free range animals. They're not caged in. They come and go as they please. We're connected to the Santa Monica Mountains, so we actually have bobcats, coyotes, a couple of mountain lions visit every once in a while, and an occasional bear. So it's a nice place to be.
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. So 433 acres, and you offer tours of the museum grounds?
Right. As a nonprofit, we have school tours come in, and we take them through. We have a village that's on site. It is an archaeological site, and so in fact, things are still being found on the property as we speak. It's we think that we've found everything, and something will pop up totally unexpected. You know, we'll have some news on one of the discoveries we just finished making, but because it's an archaeological site, it's just a great place. You know, we have stone mortars by the riverbed. We have what's called Star Rock, which is an archaeological. Something very nice, you know. It's a calendar, and we have a lot of different things, you know. So there's a lot to see.
And when I with my visit there, I noticed, you know, the very authentic replicas that were on display there. Can you talk about, you know, do you work with a consultant, or how you came to obtain these items?
Well, when we took over as curators, what we saw was a museum that was half empty, and there was a lot of displays were missing, and there was cases that had nothing in them at all. So we decided, when I say we, it's Alfred Panther and myself, who is the other part of Gray Wolf Productions. We saw an opportunity to fill these cases with something that would be unique. So we actually went out and found store mannequins that we converted into Chumash people. Alfred was very good at repainting these. Some came blonde-haired, blue-eyed, and we had to turn them from blonde-haired, blue-eyed models into Chumash people.
Uh-huh.
It was a lot of fun because, you know, we had to re-wig and eye color. Everything was changed. Alfred is a master at doing this. So it was an opportunity to use our all the knowledge we've gained in making costumes for movies and TV shows and apply it to this. So it became a lot of fun because we had to do a lot of research, just like we did with the movies. You know, when we work on a movie, we do a lot of research. So we were able to, with the help of a lot of Chumash people, with the help of the Santa Barbara Museum, and a lot of notes from John P. Harrington, we were able to put together the displays as close to what, you know, they should be as possible. Hopefully we've done a good job, you know, so we always wonder, you know, because there's so little that really is known about the Chumash, which is unfortunate because
right.
A lot was lost. And so what we're trying to do is put together from pieces, you know, what it would have been like. So you do the best you can.
Right.
You know.
And then do you have the opportunity for people to send stuff in that they've done, or?
Oh, absolutely. What we've tried to bring the Chumash back in. My association with the Chumash goes back a long way. My brother-in-law was tribal chairman of the Chumash, which means my sister married the tribal chairman, which is Edward Olivas.
Yes.
At the time, I knew nothing of the Chumash, to be honest. I knew of all the other tribes, but California tribes have been so disrespected for so long that there is very little out there about California tribes. So I, because of my brother-in-law, I felt it necessary to learn about the Chumash people and coincidentally about all the California tribes. So, you wanted to do, again, the best you could, so you talk to the Chumash people, or as many as you can.
Right.
You know,
yes.
Because this, how can you, it's just like when we do a movie. If I, when we were working on Conquest of America, I talked to all the tribes that were involved. You know, I went to the Zunis, I went to the Pueblo people, and I spoke to these people and said, well, you know, what is it that makes you who you are? I wanted to know about them. And when we were working for the History Channel, they were very impressed that we did the research we did. I remember one show we did on the Miwoks. They didn't even know what Miwoks were. Somebody kept saying Ewoks.
Yeah.
And I said, no, Miwoks, you know. But they gave us a script. We had to make the costumes. And they were really impressed. In fact, one of the producers said, "Wow, this looks like National Geographic." You know, and I said, "Wow, that's a compliment." You know, we try to do justice to the tribes. We don't try to put our feelings into what should be worn. We try to learn as much about the tribe as we can, and then put that into the show. And that's what we've done with the museum, or tried to.
Yeah, well, that's really wonderful. I see in display at the museum is the photography. You have a big photography display there as well.
Well, that was, again, see, we've been very fortunate because I have a lot of friends who are in the business, and so Ken Lubas is the photographer who takes a lot of the photos for the museum, and Ken is a Pulitzer Prize winning photographer. We're lucky to have him, you know. He's a great asset to the museum, and in fact, a lot of the people who work with us on different projects, you know, a lot of them do it as volunteers. There's very little money to pay out for projects, and so we're fortunate to have guys like Ken who are willing to come in and do this for us, you know. So we've been very fortunate.
That's great. And you talked about wanting to bring the Chumash in and have some opportunities there at the museum. You know, I know that there has been some changeover. It was at one time the Chumash Interpretive Center. Can you talk about a little about how the land itself was obtained, where it came from, its history, and kind of the change that it's gone through now, the reformation into the Chumash Indian Museum?
Well, the one thing about recent history is that nobody bothers to document things, and that's unfortunate. What I've been able to piece together with paperwork that I've found at the museum is that originally that site was going to be turned into houses, because it was called Lang Ranch. It was owned by the Lang family.
Yes.
And when the last of the Langs that had interest in the property passed away, it was left to his two daughters. His two daughters were apparently going to sell it for development, and there was going to be houses, they were going to bulldoze everything, so we'd be sitting on a mini mall probably if it wasn't for a gentleman named Paul Varela, who was instrumental in having the UCLA actually come down and do surveys of the property and deemed it to be a historical site, so or an archaeological site. So through that it was saved. And at one time, it was actually had designation as reservation. And I'm not exactly sure what that all had to do with, because I come in rather late in the whole process. So
maybe something as being in trust for the Native people?
I have paperwork, and I really am not understanding the whole situation. But in the meantime, the city of Thousand Oaks took over, not actually, first Ventura County took over the property, and then it went to the city of Thousand Oaks, where it belongs now. And it's run by Conejo Park and Rec.